Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD, General Physician. Today we'll be discussing on one of the very, very interesting topic and very useful in your everyday practice. We use every day in and out proton pump inhibitor, H2 receptor antagonist and antacids. I'll not be discussing in detail regarding antacids, but we'll be discussing more regarding what we called as proton pump inhibitor only. Mainly proton pump inhibitor and little regarding H2 receptor antagonist. Regarding antacid, we'll discuss some other time. So what are the uses, what are misuses, etc. You know very well these two famous persons in our India. We can call Prime Minister almost like proton pump inhibitor, that is perfect Prime Minister of India, and this is H2 receptor antagonist, which almost goes in hand with PPI. They are safe and effective. So we are going to discuss how safe and how effective are different proton pump inhibitor in different diseases. So I'll be discussing under different heading: introduction, indication, contraindication, side effects, complications, and prevention of complications. We know very well all these famous people, they're very nice in their speech. These are also one of the most famous people in the world. Their speech is also very good. So my speech may not be like this people. These are some of the most famous people. As well as I'll not talk the facts. No, I'll talk the facts. Not like these people, they never talk what are the facts. And I'll try to make this topic as interesting as possible. Recently, you know, this is Kisan Andolan, this is volcano, this is fire in a jungle. So these are the photographs. This is water cannon, this is flood, this is heavy rainfall, this is flooding. You can see different types of picture for flooding. This is like GERD, very, very common. Volcano is like peptic ulcer disease where there is lot of acid fire in stomach and duodenum, which will give rise to peptic ulcer disease we call DUNGU. And jungle fire is like Barrett's esophagus, and JDS is Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. These are some of the commonest condition where you will need proton pump inhibitor, etc. And most common, there is another group we call as a curling ulcer, Cushing ulcer, and we also call them as a stress ulcer. Also, it is described as stress-induced mucosal bleeding, where we use H2 receptor antagonist like water cannon, and like heavy rainfall along with flooding, that is proton pump inhibitor. And we also use antacid like a routine regular rainfall, or we call rainfall. But while using this, because of abuse, you should not end up with this type of picture, that is excessive rainfall can produce destruction. So excessive use of all these three can have side effects like this. We call unwanted side effects. We don't want unwanted side effects of rain, like flooding, like this picture. So let us go through what is proton pump inhibitor. Proton pump inhibitor are the drugs which will block pump, which is proton, into stomach, and that is active pump, that is ATP mediated pump, and by that it pours out hydrogen ions and replaces non-acidic potassium ions. And that's the reason why there is increase in hydrochloric acid production. And this PPI inhibitor will block that pump and HCl production will be reduced. We don't go into detail regarding the detailed mechanism of action. In stomach, we have got different types of cells. We are interested in parietal cells which secretes hydrochloric acid. There are G cells which secretes gastrin. Chief cells will secrete pepsin. Pepsin is protective. Mast cell will secrete histamine. This will destroy. Mucus cell will secrete mucin. So mucin and pepsin is protective. That's why it is also called as acid peptic disorder. So excess production of hydrochloric acid, decreased production of mucin, and because of this, what is called mucosal barrier will be destroyed and you will get a formation of gastric ulcer, duodenal ulcer, reflux esophagitis, etc. So acid secretion in the stomach is a continuous process. Acid secretion is increased by sight of smell, sight of food or smell of food, or at a meal time or during a stress. And when there is excessive of stress, it can be a profound increase in acid production, which can give rise to stress ulcer. Classical example, curling ulcer in extensive burns, Cushing ulcer in head injury, stroke, raised intracranial pressure, or in ICU, you can have stress ulcer. We also describe that as a stress ulcer syndrome. So there are different types of acid secretion we call basal acid secretion, where there is a complete or constant production of acid which is devoid of any stimulus and it is governed by circadian rhythm of the body. Second is gastrin stimulated secretion. In this, it is initiated by presence of food in stomach or sight or by smell or even thought of a food. And that is called gastrin stimulated. There is another we call as a histamine stimulated, which is because of secretion of histamine from mast cells. And this is very frequently following a stress or tension, which will secrete histamine. And this secretion is controlled by vagal stimulation. So vagal stimulation releases acetylcholine, which in turn stimulates the histamine, and that will increase the gastric acid production by parietal cells. So histamine stimulated is mainly during stress and other factors. So we have got three types of stimulus: basal acid production, gastrin stimulated because of presence of food in stomach or even a sight or a smell or even if a thought of food, and histamine stimulated, or we call vagal stimulated. HCl production is important because acid fluid in a stomach will kill many microbes which are present in food. It also stimulates the secretion of certain hormones that promotes the flow of bile and pancreatic juice. It is necessary for digestion of protein. It also takes part in chemical breakdown of certain types of food. And it creates an environment for absorption of certain nutrients, particularly B12 and calcium, and also iron. So these are some of the very, very important functions of presence of hydrochloric acid. So if there is any alteration in acid physiology, it can lead to certain consequences. So mismatch between aggressive forces, that is acid and pepsin, and there are defensive forces like mucosal integrity, which is being maintained by certain factors like mucus production, mucosal blood flow, bicarbonate, cell renewal, and endogenous prostaglandins. This helps in defense mechanism. And there is an acid production and pepsin production, which will, if the production is increased, and if the defense mechanism is broken or decreased, then it can give rise to acid peptic digestion of mucosa, which will lead to ulcer formation. So there are certain factors like H. pylori, there are certain host factors, environmental factors like alcohol, smoking, steroid, NSAID, fried foods, pickles, which is very rich in spicy material, spicy oily foods, etc. And that will give rise to H. pylori, host factors, environmental factors. That will give rise to enteral gastritis or may give rise to pangastritis. Enteral gastritis will end up into duodenal ulcer and gastric ulcer, while pangastritis will produce by and large gastric ulcer. So that will be very common and it can end up into gastric carcinoma. So these are some of the factors which can be there. So we always say aggressive factors like H. pylori, NSAID, smoking, etc. Those are the aggressive factors, while defensive factor is mucus production and bicarbonate barrier. Then mucosal blood flow, prostaglandins and epithelial regeneration. So these are defensive factors. And there has to be a very nice balance. If there is increase in aggressive factor and decrease in mucosal barrier factor, will result into acid peptic digestion of mucosa, and that will end up into, so aggravating factor if it increases and defensive factor which decreases, it will end up into peptic ulcer disorder. So defensive factors are bicarbonate, mucus layer, mucosal blood flow, epithelial renewal, and in aggressive factor or factor which will induce ulcer formation. So those can be NSAID, steroid, pepsin, bile acid, smoking, alcohol, hypoxia, ischemia, very common in ICU. Also, you can get vasoconstriction during stress. So that will end up with a mucosal damage resulting into erosion and ulceration. We call acid peptic digestion. So these are all aggressive factors. These are protective factors, which we have already mentioned before. So all these factors will stimulate. This factor will try to protect. So decrease in this factor and aggravation of acid, pepsin, bile, H. pylori, steroids, smoking, alcohol, NSAID, stress, free radical, oily, spicy, irregular diet habits, and very rarely hereditary factors. These are some of the factors. I'm going a little faster. You know very well, we call Helicobacterium pylori infections, drugs like NSAID, anticoagulants, oral steroids, chemotherapeutic agents, alcohol consumption, stress like burns, stroke, head injury, even raised intracranial pressure, post-surgical, sepsis, Cushing ulcers. Cushing ulcer is associated with increased gastric output in stomach and duodenum. And this will be very frequently in case of CNS trauma or even stroke, raised intracranial pressure, etc. Even in a multiple traumatic injury also, a person can end up with what we call as a Cushing ulcer. Usually in the burns, when the person gets, we call that as a curling ulcer. And in an ICU, we will come across very frequently a person with sepsis or with hypoxia or with severe shock stage. And that we usually call as stress-induced symptoms, stress induced. There are some hypersecretory state, particularly where you get a tumor of gastrin secreting cells, we call Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. Not very common cystic fibrosis, and in case of a multiple endocrine neoplasia, nowadays it is called multiple endocrine adenomatosis, MEA. In that also, you can come across Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, where you can have excessive acid production, T-cell hyperplasia, that is gastrinomas, hyperparathyroidism, basophilic leukemias, short bowel syndromes, etc. can also have excessive acid production. Very rarely in genetic groups. Usually they say that who do not secrete ABO antigen in their saliva or gastric juice are at a high risk of getting these disorders. And there is a condition called as a familial hyperpepsinogenemia type 1. Occasionally, it can happen along with radiation therapy because of mucosal damage, and that can end up with duodenal ulcer and peptic ulcer disease. It can also occur along with hepatic cirrhosis, COPD, Hanoxolan purpura, autoimmune, Crohn's disease, graft versus host disease, emphysematous gastritis, bile-induced or uremic-induced gastropathy. Also, it can be associated with infection like cytomegalovirus, herpes simplex, HIV, Helicobacter infection, Epstein-Barr virus, C. albicans, histoplasma, etc. Drugs like cocaine, which can produce vasoconstriction, decrease in the blood flow, and damage. We already mentioned stress, depression, smoking, social deprivation. Again, that can end up with stress and depression. Person who has got a previous history of peptic ulcer disease are more prone to anemia, etc. also can be some of the factors. So we always say acid, H. pylori, diet and drugs. In which? In diet, hurry, worry and curry. And in drugs, NSAID steroids. They are the prime most common factor. Increased acid production, H. pylori organism, diet and drugs becomes the most common causes. There is always a term, no acid, no ulcer. No acid, no H. pylori, no ulcer. No H. pylori, no NSAID, no ulcer. So indirectly, acid, H. pylori and NSAID are more prone for ulcer. So commonly we use a term peptic ulcer disease where increased acid production, H. pylori and other factors are responsible for peptic ulcer disease. The site-wise in peptic ulcer disease, we always use the word gastric ulcer, duodenal ulcer. The site of peptic ulcer disease in duodenum, it accounts for almost 80%. And gastric ulcer is accounting for 19%. 4% is common in duodenum as well as stomach. So gastric and duodenal ulcer can coexist in 4% of the people. And 1% at gastroesophageal junction, gastrojejunostomy sites, and in Meckel's diverticulum. Not very common. It is accounting for only 1%. So highest is DU. Second common is gastric ulcer. Combination is only 4%, and rare sites like gastroesophageal junction, that is lower end of the esophagus, gastrojejunostomy sites and Meckel's diverticulum is accounting for only 1%. We already mentioned the pathogenesis, that is the most common pathogenesis is because of reflux esophagitis. So, all those what we have discussed before can end up into acid peptic disorders, which can involve esophagus, we call reflux esophagitis, non-erosive reflux disease, short form it is called NERD. Not reflux esophageal disorders. It is a variety of a reflux disease where there is no erosion of mucosa. That's why it is labeled as non-erosive reflux disease. But it is one of the variety of gastroesophageal reflux disease. But in gastroesophageal, usually we come across involvement of the mucous membrane. While here there is no erosion. So there are two terminology which are being utilized. GERD, which can end up into reflux esophagitis. And there is a non-erosive reflux disease. You can have a non-cardiac chest pain. When there is an excessive use of NSAID, which induces inflammation of stomach mucosa, we call it as NSAID-induced gastritis. When it results into a breach in continuity of mucosal layer and ulcer formation, we usually use the word peptic ulcer, or we use acid peptic ulcer, or we call peptic ulcer disease, which can be involving stomach mucosa, we call gastric ulcer. It involves duodenal mucosa, we call DU ulcer. It can also produce functional dyspepsia. And you can have a gastrointestinal hypersecretory conditions like Jollinger-Ellison syndrome, which is secondary due to gastrinomas, etc. So this is the entire pathophysiology of GERD, where the lower esophageal sphincter is being affected, which can be because of transient mechanism or relaxation problem, or because of decreased tone in the muscle, we call hypotensive. So it can be transient lower esophageal sphincter involvement of relaxation. So transient lower esophageal sphincter relaxation, hypotensive lower esophageal sphincter, or it can be associated with hiatus hernia. And there is a bile reflux, slow gastric emptying, increased intragastric pressure because of obesity, lying flat or tight belt, etc. There is an increased acid output because of smoking or tea, coffee, or by pickles, etc. Or there is an H. pylori infection. All that will increase H. ion production, pepsin production will be increased, and decrease in gastric mucosa barrier. There will be peristalsis which will be affected. There is decreased production of salivary bicarbonates. So decreased esophageal clearance of acid by lying down flat, alcohol, coffee, etc. And that will produce involvement of lower end of esophagus. So there is an impaired mucosal defense, increased acid production, and decrease in mucosal barrier, increase in acid contact will result into GERD symptoms, and erosion of esophageal mucosa will call as a reflux esophagitis, and then person can develop esophageal ulcer, Barrett esophagus, and in a late stage even esophageal carcinoma. So this will be all the different mechanism which can be there in a GERD. So these are some of the factors which are being there. Smoking, alcohol, medications, what it will produce because of smoking, decrease in lower esophageal sphincter tone. Alcohol can produce mucosal damage. Medication can produce mucosal damage with weakening of lower esophageal sphincter. Spicy foods, heavy meals, etc. can produce gastric distension, weakening of lower esophageal sphincter. Irritation of esophageal mucosa, H. pylori can induce gastritis, nasogastric tubes conduit for acid reflux in supine posture, abdominal trauma can produce diaphragm disruption, etc. Obesity can increase intra-abdominal pressure, diabetes mellitus can decrease gastric emptying time, Jollinger-Ellison syndrome will increase acid output, in pregnancy, intra-abdominal pressure and weakening of lower esophageal sphincter, in achalasia, destruction of a lower esophageal sphincter because of myotomy, CRST syndrome can impair peristalsis. Actually, it should be CEST syndrome, CREST syndrome, CREST. Psycha syndrome can also impair esophageal clearance. Psychiatric disorders can decrease the esophageal motility. Mental retardation can also decrease the motility. All this will end up into GERD and can produce different changes. Now, most common disorder we come across is GERD, which is producing multiple symptoms. You can have esophageal syndrome and extra esophageal syndrome. In esophageal syndrome, typical reflux, and you can get chest pain. Here, burning sensation in lower part of the esophagus, and reflux can involve the entire esophagus, can produce a retrosternal chest pain, which is sometimes mistaken even as an ischemic heart disease. And secondary to continuous reflux, it can end up into reflux esophagitis, stricture formation, Barrett esophagus, and in late stage adenocarcinoma. Why? Because of constant reflux, person can get nocturnal cough or reflux cough, reflux laryngitis, reflux asthma, and reflux dental erosion. Also, person can develop pharyngitis, sinusitis, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, and occasionally even otitis media. All these are worst complications secondary due to long-term effects on GERD, on oropharyngeal mucosa, and this will be the effect on what we call as a trachea and larynx. So do remember this. That's why we always say all pain in epigastrium may or may not be because of heartburns. That is, may not be because of GERD or peptic ulcer disease. It can be secondary because of many other conditions. If you go through GERD, in 87% of the people, there is an acid regurgitation symptoms and signs. Stomach involvement is in 45%. Almost mimicking like chest pain, like angina in 35%, heartburns in 30%. Dyspepsia and dysphagia is only in 6.5%, while dyspepsia is in almost 30%. And atypical, like chronic cough, laryngeal involvement, asthma in a small percentage. And NCCP, that is, we call as, it is involvement of the nasopharyngeal mucosa. You can get esophagitis, which are grade according to the involvement, like grade 1, grade 2, or grade A, grade B, grade C, and grade D, where the person starts getting bleeding. So depending upon the depth and area of involvement, there are different grades which are being given. Here there is a small difference between peptic ulcer and stress ulcer. So in peptic ulcer, usually it is chronic, while in stress ulcer, it is acute. Stress ulcer is also called as curling ulcer in case of extensive burns. And in case of a head injury, raised intracranial pressure. And in case of a stroke, it is called Cushing ulcer. In ICU, it is called as a stress ulcer syndrome, or also called as a stress-related mucosal bleeding. Location-wise, peptic ulcer is very common in enterum part, while stress ulcer is common in fundus, body, and cardia part of stomach. Usually in peptic ulcer, it is single or maybe one or two, while this is a multiple ulcer in case of a stress ulcer. In case of a peptic ulcer, it is abdominal pain, may lead to perforation and bleeding. Usually in case of a stress ulcer, very rarely they produce perforation, but they can produce abdominal pain, and bleeding is quite common. peptic ulcer, usually we go for endoscopy or you can utilize barium mill. Barium mill is not very useful in diagnosis of curling ulcer because they are superficial ulcers. They are better diagnosed by endoscopy only. Now, if we go through the treatment part, usually we utilize H2 receptor antagonist, which is cimetidine is now out of date. Usually now we use famotidine or ranitidine, that is H2 receptor antagonist and proton pump inhibitor, that is omeprazole, pentaprazole, rabeprazole, S-omeprazole, S-rabeprazole, etc. There are many lansoprazole, etc. Anticholinergic are not commonly utilized. Prostaglandins analogs are also not commonly used, that is misoprostol. Antacids, which is containing aluminum, magnesium, simethicone, or bicarbonates. Ulcer protective, or we call gastric mucosa protection by sucralfate. For H. pylori, amoxicillin with clarithromycin and metronidazole, most common combination. And bismuth containing subsalicylate, not commonly utilized, but is utilized in some of the conditions. Now, if we go through the indications of, mainly we are talking of proton pump inhibitor or H2 receptor antagonist, or sometimes they combine both in some of the conditions. But I am giving in general regarding a proton pump inhibitor. The most common indication is peptic ulcer disease like DUGU and reflux esophagitis. Treatment and prevention of gastric ulcer due to person who is on a chronic treatment for NSAID. In eradication of H. pylori, it is combined with amoxicillin, clarithromycin and what we call as a metronidazole. In Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, or we call as a gastrinomas, Barrett esophagus or Barrett metaplasia, in GERD, esophageal stricture and extra esophageal manifestation, we have already shown you the slide, which can produce reflux, laryngitis, cough, asthma, interstitial fibrosis, etc. There are a lot of things which can happen, even dental erosions. Any one of those signs, you should use proton pump inhibitor. So these are good number of indications which are being there. So the most common which we use is in reflux esophagitis. Also in case of a non-erosive reflux disorder, non-cardiac chest pain, which is very frequently because of GERD, NSAID-induced gastritis, in peptic ulcer, functional dyspepsia, etc. Also, proton pump inhibitor or H2 receptor antagonist is utilized. So, in GERD, peptic ulcer, gastric ulcer, gastroparesis, in functional dyspepsia, H. pylori infections, in all this condition, very frequently proton pump inhibitor are utilized. So, these are all the guidelines which is being laid down by different institution, which are the conditions, that is GERD, esophagitis, Barrett esophagus, along with NSAID, antiplatelet, along with antiplatelet agents, Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, etc. It is American College of Gastroenterology. American College of Gastroenterology. So that particular institution has given these guidelines. At your leisure time, you can go through. We divide into short-term use, means we give for a short period, and then as soon as the person gets good relief, that is stopped. Like peptic ulcer disease, GUDU, GERD, reflux esophagitis, etc. H. pylori eradication. In ICU, in critically ill patient, and if the person has got functional dyspepsia, for short-term use. But for long-term, means you give it for more than 6 to 8 weeks, that is GERD, Barrett esophagus, and if the person has to be on NSAID for a long term. It should be combined, or person who is on a dual antiplatelet drugs, good number of time it is combined. Or also in case of a functional dyspepsia, or we call non-ulcer dyspepsia, sometime it is given for long term. In all these conditions, it is given for more than 6 to 8 weeks, means more than 2 months. Then we call that as a long-term treatment. In case of a stress ulcer syndrome, which is very frequently seen in person who are admitted in ICU and who are under constant stress, usually they develop mucosal erosions, they might bleed, and very rarely they perforate. And that combined together is called stress ulcer syndrome. Very frequently it is given when already it is detected, or it is also given as a prophylaxis before a person develops stress ulcer syndrome. So very frequently this is one of the treatment. Also in case of a curling ulcer in burns, Cushing ulcer in stroke, head injury, raised intracranial pressure, etc. And we also call as stress-related mucosal bleeding, which is one of the finding in stress ulcer syndrome. You come across in case of a person who is admitted in ICU with multiple disorders and multiple complications. So there is what we call as a stress-related mucosal bleeding. You will come across occult bleeding in 15 to 50%, overt bleeding in 5 to 25%, and you will come across upper GI bleeding in 1 to 2.5%, endoscopic evidence in almost 75 to 100%, good number of times. And morbidity will increase fourfold. So you must detect them, what we call as a stress-related mucosal bleeding. Short form they call as SRMB. Ideally, we should use a full form, stress-related mucosal bleeding. Very, very common. And epidemiology of this is usually the most of the patient within 1 or 2 days after ICU admission will have stress ulcer or stress-related mucosal damage, and that will increase the mortality in critically ill patient. So this should be paid attention. Good number of time prophylactic proton pump inhibitors are given. So prophylaxis can be given and early resuscitation should be done. And these are all the risk factors which are being explained because of respiratory failure, hypoxia, and person who is on mechanical ventilation, AKI, liver failure, spinal cord injury and head injury, which also can result into Cushing ulcer, burns, major surgery, anticoagulation, person develops coagulopathy, sepsis, hypertension, high dose of steroids, as well as enteral feeding. All these things predisposes to stress-related mucosal involvement and mucosal bleeding. So all these factors, age, renal failure, male, respiratory failure, MI, AKI, neurological injury, sepsis, shock, acute or chronic hepatic failure, coagulopathy, liver damage, renal replacement therapy, all these factors can produce. So in the critical illness, it is because of reduced bicarbonate secretion, decreased blood flow, decreased GI motility, and acid diffusion back. So all these factors can end up into acute stress ulcer. So now there is also another very important indication, that is for high dose proton pump inhibitor for diagnosis. And this is called diagnostic trial, proton pump inhibitor test, PPI test. In an uncomplicated GERD, if there is no alarm symptoms, then in that particular person, you give for 8 weeks therapeutic or empiric trial of double dose of proton pump inhibitor, means 20 milligram of rabeprazole twice daily or 40 milligram of pantoprazole twice daily, etc. Either of the two. Or you can use pentaprazole, lansoprazole, or you can use omeprazole, rabeprazole, anyone, but double dose. And it has to be given for minimum 8 weeks, and then you reevaluate. If there is no response, you reevaluate, and if there is no response after 8 weeks, we usually say that it is not GERD, it is something else. So dose given is 20 milligram twice daily or esomeprazole, 40 milligram once daily or 20 milligram twice daily, omeprazole 20 milligram twice daily, lansoprazole 60 milligram daily, etc. And you see the response. So it is one of the tests, very, very important. So also if the person who is having chronic cough, particularly nocturnal cough, and you are suspecting because of GERD, you again give same, that is high dose, that is twice or double the dose, and see the response. And it is given for, again, for 8 weeks. And look for the response for dry and non-productive cough and the response. If the person gets dramatic response, it was GERD related nocturnal cough, or we call extra gastric symptoms and signs, which is very, very common because of acid regurgitation, which involves nasal mucosa, oropharyngeal mucosa, and involvement of larynx, which can produce reflux related asthma, interstitial pulmonary fibrosis, laryngitis, etc. Also, high dose is very commonly given initially in gastric ulcer, in Joliger-Ellison syndrome. Sometimes it is also given up to 240 milligram per day in this particular condition. But if a person who is having gastric ulcer or who are at high risk of NSAID treatment, especially particular person who is on a very high dose of NSAID, say a person has got multiple fractures, major surgery, in those particular group to reduce the pain, very frequently NSAID are used. In that condition, you might have to use a high dose proton pump inhibitor, or we call double dose of proton pump inhibitor. Also sometime in H. pylori eradication to reduce the recurrence of duodenal ulcer, along with dual or triple antibiotic therapy, it has to be given full therapeutic dose. Sometimes we give double dose of proton pump inhibitor for first 2 weeks, and then we cut down the dose. So this has to be given in this particular condition. Also, if there is an endoscopic evidence of severe erosive esophagitis, or there is a presence of ulceration, stricture, perforation, or bleeding, or there is a presence of Barrett esophagus, high dose is absolutely necessary. Again, we call double dose of proton pump inhibitor. And it should be continued with double dose as a maintenance therapy. Good number of time it is given for a very long treatment, that is more than 8 weeks. Also, for prevention of acute re-bleeding in an peptic ulcer after endoscopic hemostasis, it has to be given in a high dose. Good number of time it is injectable form for first 2 to 3 days, and then followed by high dose therapy for another few days, and then maintenance dose. Also, in case of a stress bleeding in critically ill patient, it has to be given for minimum 2 weeks, or may require even longer with high dose, or we call double dose proton pump inhibitor. If there is lack of response by high dose for adequate period of time, it may be because of a wrong diagnosis, because person may be having malignancy, and pain because of non-acid related like gallstone, pancreatic disease or colonic disease where proton pump inhibitor will not work. So this also gives you an idea. If the person does not respond, do look for other conditions. That's why we call it a PPI test. It's very, very useful. In GERD, nocturnal acid breakthrough, esophageal and gastric motility disorders, and lower esophageal sphincter dysfunction, it is given for short period till you get a relief, because you want to break this cycle in GERD. This, all these three conditions, if they are present in GERD, you will use for that period. If there is lack of response, do suspect Barrett esophagus. Peptic ulcer is not responding, always try to rule out the person maybe on aspirin or maybe on an NSAID, long-term use. Or what we call as, we use the word resistance, or person has got tolerance. Try to rule out that. There are some use which are odd use, or we call non-classical use. Particularly in case of a hemochromatosis, pancreatic insufficiency, proton pump inhibitor responsive eosinophilic esophagitis. This is one very odd conditions where you get eosinophilic infiltration into esophagus leading to esophagitis and which are responsive to proton pump inhibitor. Also, it is given in bleeding which you have done an endoscopy, and if the person is having early bleeding risk after prophylactic endoscopic varicose band ligation, this is what is done for varices, that is band ligation, endoscopic band ligation, or you have done some procedure for that varicose bleeding and you have got high chance of bleeding risk, then in that case proton pump is given. Also, proton pump produces anti-inflammatory effect and antibacterial effect. That's why it is also utilized in combination for H. pylori treatment. So it has got little amount of antioxidative and anti-inflammatory property. And it is also utilized along with what we call as H. pylori infections treatment. Now, in newly diagnosed dyspepsia or newly diagnosed GERD, proton pump is not the first line of treatment. So try to avoid that. Try to decrease the risk factors which are there for GERD or for functional dyspepsia. Try to do that first instead of starting with proton pump inhibitor. As far as this flow chart is concerned, this is a very good flow chart. If a person who is a primary care consultant, he'll take a good history. And if he finds out the person is having typical symptoms of heartburns and regurgitations, and then he gives a proton pump inhibitor treatment for breakthrough. And if there is a relief, you give maintenance dose along with antacids you can give. If there is a recurrent symptoms, treatment is intensified by making double dose. And now if he gets a relief, you continue with maintenance therapy of proton pump inhibitor with other precautions. And then you go for a step down therapy. If still there is a recurrent, then now you should go for ruling out what we call as non-responsive conditions, Barrett esophagus, malignancy, or maybe other disorders like gallbladder disorders, pancreatic disorders, etc. Try to rule out those conditions. If there is an alarming symptoms like dysphagia, persistent vomiting, frequent vomiting, GI bleeding, weight loss, directly go for diagnostic evaluation. Don't wait for proton pump inhibitor effects. We call alarming symptoms. There are some non-alarming symptoms like bronchial asthma, or we call acid reflux asthma, chronic cough, chronic hoarseness, nausea and vomiting, unexplained chest pain, interstitial fibrosis, dental erosions, etc. Again, go for diagnostic evaluation and start treatment as early as possible. While giving a diagnostic evaluation, you should treat them with proton pump inhibitor. And if symptoms recur on maintenance therapy, again you should go for high dose therapy. And if he doesn't get response, then he should undergo diagnostic evaluation. There are some red flag signs which are very, very important, like chest pain, which is like a cardiac chest pain. There's a choking sensation, person gets dysphagia, there's a bleeding, there is odynophagia, so pain is on swallowing, or person gets anemia, there's a persistent vomiting, there is severe abdominal pain. In all these conditions, you should investigate thoroughly by an expert. And there are some diagnostic evaluation which are available, like endoscopy, barium swallow. You can go for 24 hours monitoring of pH. PPI test can be utilized. Birth stain tests can be also utilized. The most important is endoscopic examination, PPI test, and you can go for esophageal manometry and pH in esophagus. Treatment-wise, the first treatment should be lifestyle modification for management of GERD, that is reduction in the weight, elevate the head of the bed, alternative treatment which promotes reflux drugs like theophylline anticholinergic should be avoided. Eat small meals, regular meals, reduce fat, no late time meals, means don't take evening meals, late night meals, avoid alcohol, coffee, spicy food, tobacco, etc. Stop smoking. All these are the part and parcel of lifestyle modification. So avoid food that precipitates GERD. Avoid lying downs. Ideal body weight. Reduce your body weight. Stop alcohol. Stop smoking. Stop caffeine, etc. Small, more frequent meals. No late night meals. There are some more things like this. Reassure the patient about benign conditions, stress reduction, avoid exercise or bending on a full stomach, avoid exacerbating food, lying down after meals, some person has got habit, tight clothes around the waist, head raising, stop smoking, indirectly nicotine consumption, and maintain your ideal body weights. Now, if a person has got symptoms, and if he is having an alarming symptom, straightforward he should go for endoscopy and rule out non-erosive reflux disorder. Reflux disorders, or we call reflux esophagitis, and complicated reflux disease. Also investigate for risk assessment and go for empiric treatment. So non-erosive are quite common, so you can pick up those. Start from lifestyle modification, antacids, then you can combine both together. This is the most common things which you should do. Lifestyle modification with antacids, If you don't get response, usually H2 receptor antagonist with prokinetic or prokinetic with H2 receptors is the best. Still, if you don't get response, now usually you start with proton pump inhibitor, and if you don't get response, double the dose of proton pump inhibitor. Or sometime they go to double dose of proton pump inhibitor combining with H2 receptor antagonist. Depending upon your clinical judgment and depending upon your endoscopic findings, we have already mentioned before. So antacids, H2 receptor antagonist and proton pump inhibitor are utilized. The most common antacid which is utilized is aluminum hydroxide, magnesium and calcium. I'm not going to discuss in detail regarding antacids. Some other time we'll be discussing on antacids, particularly what are the side effects of antacid consumption. And this is one of the drug which is very frequently misused. So we'll try to discuss some other time. Usually in H2 receptor antagonist, now H2 receptor blocker we call, is famotidine and ranitidine. And in proton pump, most commonly utilizes omeprazole, brentaprazole and rabeprazole. Sucralfate is one of the gastric protective which protects the barrier on the surface of gastric mucosa. It stimulates the mucosa and bicarbonate production. It also stimulates the epidermal growth and renewal, and it improves the mucosal blood flow by increasing the prostaglandin release. Hence, sucralfate is very useful. And when you combine sucralfate with H2 receptor antagonist or proton pump inhibitor, it will increase the protection and it will decrease the damage to the mucosa. So antacids, H2 receptor antagonist, prokinetic drugs like domperidone, sisapride is gone out of date, and proton pump inhibitor can be utilized. In a non-erosive disorders, non-erosive reflux disorders, omeprazole is usually given in a single dose, that is 20 milligram, or lansoprazole 30 or pentaprazole 40. Rabeprazole is usually given in the form of 10 milligram or esomeprazole 40 milligram for minimum 4 weeks, and results are observed. So in a GERD, we have already shown you a chart before. Accordingly, you can go through. If there is an episodic heartburns, what happens if there is a occasional meal provoked heartburns, or if there is a frequent moderate to severe heartburns, and if there is an alarming symptoms, what you do. Again, a good flow chart is given. At your leisure time, you can go through. We already shown one. This is another flow charts. If you are interested, you can go through your at your leisure time. Usually with a heartburn, we start with a H2 receptor antagonist or proton pump inhibitor. H2 receptor antagonists are taken twice a day, or there are OD dose also available. The drug preparation with OD dose are also available. If there is a good response, then you can continue with that. If good response, answer is yes. If there is a frequent response, frequent relapses, if answer is no, then you can go for on-demand treatment. If you are using a proton pump inhibitor, if there is a good response, answer is yes, maintenance therapy at a low dose. Symptom persist, you can continue with further treatment and go for investigations. If there is no response, increase the dose to BID dose. Now if you get a good response, if answer is yes, go for maintenance therapy. If answer is no, go for investigations. So that these are called in GERD stage 1, stage 2, stage 3. Usually in stage 1, it is uncomplicated. In stage 2, there are symptoms with or without esophagitis. And in stage 3, there are complications which are being there, in which you will require a proton pump inhibitor for a long-term therapy and treatment of complications. While in stage 1, usually lifestyle modification with H2 receptor antagonist and antacids, or if person doesn't get response, then you can go for proton pump inhibitor. In summary, proton pump inhibitor difference. It is effective, gives rise to ATP stimulation, so we call active pump. As far as side effect is concerned, diarrhea, nausea, headache, and abdominal pain are common. While in case of an H2 receptor blocker, the effect is only for 12 hours. Onset is less than 1 hour. Common symptoms are sore throat, diarrhea, nausea, vomiting. And usually it is utilized in a person who has got an early heartburn or a mild variety. It is not so effective in case of a Barrett's esophagus, reflux esophagitis, severe duodenal ulcer, gastric ulcer, etc., where proton pump inhibitor should be utilized. It scores over H2 receptors. We always require a good change for good results. You can see here, right from all these people, we require a good person, good change. So as the time passes, from omeprazole, we have got recently esomeprazole, and newer are coming. They are in pipelines. So you've got omeprazole, pentaprazole. Now we have got different compounds which are coming in market slowly. Now if we go through that, I'll cut down very shortly. Most commonly we utilize pentaprazole, omeprazole, and rabeprazole. Out of which, if you see properly, pentaprazole has got almost no drug interaction and rabeprazole has got almost no drug interaction. While omeprazole has got good amount of drug interaction with diazepam, warfarin, digoxin, phenytoin, ketoconazole, etc. Even lansoprazole has got with ketoconazole. So the base drug is pentaprazole and rabeprazole. These two are the base drugs. So try to utilize those drugs most commonly. Now if we go through the adverse effect of proton pump inhibitor, there are some common adverse effect which you will come across in a proton pump inhibitor is abdominal pain, constipation, diarrhea, headache, nausea, vomiting. And sometimes these are mistaken as exacerbation of the symptoms and we continue with proton pump inhibitor. And person will not tolerate proton pump inhibitor. Very rarely we consider that proton pump inhibitor has produced those symptoms. But it is almost more than 1%. Very rarely you come across anaphylaxis, sleep disturbances, hypomagnesemia. Gynecomastia is quite common with, it was very common with cimetidine, but not very common. Muscle pain and interstitial nephritis is now considered as a side effects which is slowly detected. So do keep it in mind. So diarrhea, abdominal pain, constipation, rash, interstitial nephritis, hypomagnesemia, hypophosphatemia, metabolic alkalosis. And when you administer with sodium bicarbonate, it can produce other side effects, particularly metabolic alkalosis. Also because of decrease in the acid production, vitamin B12 deficiency, and calcium absorption, which can result into fractures. Also because of decreased acid production, Clostridium difficilis infections and nosocomial pneumonia, quite common. We divide into two big groups, short-term side effects and long-term side effects. So these are some of the common adverse reaction which you can come across. like headache, abdominal pain, diarrhea, constipation, nausea, vomiting, flatulence, and uncommon like dermatitis, pruritus, urticaria, dizziness, vertigo, dry mouth, etc. We already mentioned this again and again. Some uncommon side effects like rash, itching, flatulence, constipation, anxiety, depression, etc. are some of the common. But diarrhea, nausea, vomiting, they are some of the common adverse side effects. We are more interested in long term because when it is used for a long term, it will give rise to multiple common side effects. And there is always a question which is frequently asked. And some of those are being proven also. Like they reduce the absorption of vitamins and minerals. There is a high chance of Clostridium difficilis infection. There is also a possibility of interstitial nephritis. In some of the cases, there is also dementia which has been observed. You can also see sometime gastric carcinoma, which is not been proven, but there's always a possibility of increased chance of gastric and colonic carcinoma, etc. So these are multiple things which are being there. Still, some of those are not well established, but some of the conditions are possible side effects for long-term use are included is gastric carcinomas, gastric carcinoid syndromes, decreased absorption of iron, calcium, vitamin B12, magnesium, which can give rise to hypomagnesemia, hypocalcemia, fractures, anemia, iron deficiency anemia, B12 deficiency, etc. Enteric infection like Clostridium difficile, which can produce pneumonia. You can have a cardiovascular event. Even it has been associated with interstitial nephritis and can end up with CKD. It is also being seen that it is associated with dementia. Some odd things are already being seen in proton pump chronic therapy like gynecomastia, increased risk, extrapyramidal side effects, calcium and vitamin D deficiency. So hypergastrinemia, polyposis, drug interaction, B12 metabolism and pernicious anemia, osteopenia and osteoporosis because of calcium absorption, community acquired pneumonias, bacterial overgrowths, Clostridium difficilis infection, etc. Drug interaction is quite common with what we call as more common with esomeprazole and also with, it is less with pantoprazole. It is less with pantoprazole and rabeprazole. It is more common with omeprazole. There is drug interaction with ketoconazole, etc. Also, proton pump inhibitor has got drug interaction with clopidogrel, which can interfere and can produce chance of bleeding. Iron and B12 absorption is also affected. You will have a hypergastrinemia. And there is increased gastrin-induced hyperplasia that will produce fundic gland polyposis, which is quite common and can end up into malignancy. This is that gastric fundic gland polyps. Community-acquired pneumonia is very common in person who are on a long-term therapy. And this is because of bacterial translocation. There is also chance of what we call as a Clostridium-induced infection, that is Clostridium difficilis infection. Quite common. Because of abnormal absorption of calcium. Calcium absorption is reduced, so it gives rise to metabolic bone disease and chances of osteoporosis and fractures increases. So bone fragility also increases. and there are a lot of papers and lot of journals where it is mentioned that proton pump inhibitor will produce kidney disorders, may also exaggerate end-stage renal disease and CKD. Acute interstitial nephritis can occur. It is also associated with dementia. There are some documentation that is it may be increasing the high risk of myocardial infarction, ischemic cardiovascular events, anemia. It has got drug interaction with clopidogrel. Even it can produce hyperparathyroidism. Clostridium difficilis infection is associated. Hypomagnesemia, absorption of B12, iron and calcium can be affected. Even absorption of L-thyroxine is affected. It can induce childhood asthma. This has been well established that it interferes with clopidogrel absorption, iron absorption, magnesium absorption. And it can also increase the incidence of Clostridium difficilis infections. And also now it has been almost established that it can produce sometime acute interstitial nephritis. We have lost 25 years and we have not noticed this, all these complications. And now all this has come. So it is like this, people. There are a lot of journals which has mentioned all these complications, right from BMA journal, Circulation, JAMA, all these different journal, nephrology journals, etc. And they are constantly mentioning, even recently in 2017, 2018, 2019 also, all these journals are mentioning that proton pump inhibitor can produce complications. Nutan, so that can produce kidney disease, end-stage renal disease, dementia, etc. And those are being mentioned very clearly in different journals and different papers. It can also produce hypergastrinemia. Proton pump inhibitor is associated with high gastrin level. It has been also established that because of achlorhydria, there will be malabsorption of magnesium leading to hypomagnesemia. Malabsorption of calcium and vitamin B12 will result into bone loss and increased fracture. Well established. So now H2 receptor antagonists do not have some of these side effects like proton pump inhibitor. So in those particular group, proton pump inhibitor can be replaced by H2 receptor antagonist, which was published in journal in 2015. So in such cases, you can utilize H2 receptor antagonist, which has got less chance of fractures. So you can utilize in those particular group. As far as H2 receptor antagonist side effect is concerned, constipation, diarrhea, dry mouth, headaches, running nose, etc. are quite common. Now, USA FDA clearly mentions proton pump should be not used for a long term if person has got increased chance of osteoporotic fractures. Also, it decreases the effectiveness of clopidogrel. So it should not be given in a person with a cardiovascular event where they are on a dual therapy or they are on a clopidogrel. Dual platelet therapy is combination of aspirin with clopidogrel or even with clopidogrel therapy. And there is increased risk of pneumonias. Also, there is an increased risk of Clostridium difficilis infections. It should not be utilized. So, in such cases, instead of proton pump inhibitor, utilization of H2 receptor antagonist is preferred. particularly in a person with a high risk of bone fractures. So PPIs is restricted in some of the conditions, particularly to reduce B12 absorption, calcium absorption, magnesium absorption, and reduce chance of gastrinemia, gastrin-related complications. Use with caution. So, potent acid inhibitor may lead to potent adverse effect. That should be kept in mind, like increased risk fractures, hypomagnesemia, dementia, gastrinemia, risk of infection like Clostridium difficile infections, B12 deficiency, iron deficiency, etc. Where you should think advantage over disadvantage, that is adverse side effect. You should not forget kidney involvement, dementia, clopidogrel interactions, malabsorption of B12, iron and calcium. Also don't forget thyroid. This has been well approved. B12 deficiency, Clostridium difficilis, associated diarrhea, hypomagnesemia, interstitial nephritis has been well established. So this should be kept in mind while using proton pump inhibitors. There are newer drugs which are coming in market. They will be mainly studied for all those complications. So try, they are in search of a molecule which will have a less number of those side effects. These people are always confused. You have to decide what to do. What is most important is lifestyle modification. Use antacids for acid neutralization and then think of H2 receptor antagonist or proton pump inhibitor. So most important is stop smoking, weight loss, eating habits should be changed, stop alcohol and posture after meal, avoid NSAID, steroids, etc. So NSAID should be avoided, steroids should be avoided, stress should be avoided, all those should be done. And this should be taken only after proper advice. So this should be kept in mind. Alcohol, smoking should be avoided. Drugs should be avoided. These are the most important thing before thinking of starting proton pump inhibitor and H2 receptor antagonist. Don't consume milk and soda, which is a very common advice which is being given. You have to decide what you want to do. So always use proton pump inhibitor and H2 receptor antagonist with caution. There are some treatment, basic treatment, which are being very frequently for stress ulcer and curling ulcer is cytoprotection should be done by sucralfate. And this can be one of the protective mechanism for mucosa. You can utilize H2 receptor antagonist first along with antacids and cytoprotection. And if there is an active bleeding, you might require surgical intervention and enteral feedings. Ranitidine and famotidine is most commonly H2 receptor antagonists which are being utilized in recent practice. And if it does not give response, then only proton pump inhibitors. Also, as a prophylaxis for stress ulcer, you can prefer enteral feeding. You can utilize cytoprotection by sucralfate, hemodynamic management, oxygen supplement, prevent hypoxia, and also you can utilize H2 receptor antagonist. These are some of the side effects of antacids. Side effects, I've kept a slide, but I'm not going into detail because I'll be taking separately in another separate lecture on only antacids. So in a take-home message, proton pump inhibitor to be administered 30 minutes before breakfast. Good number of time this is given after meal, which will reduce the effects. Twice the dose should be utilized in a case where you want to have maximum suppression of acid for acute episodes. Rabeprazole is acid labile and there is a rapid onset of action. This should be kept in mind. So it should not be given after meal. Rational concomitant use of proton pump inhibitor and antiplatelet should be thought over. So combination of proton pump inhibitor with antiplatelet, particularly clopidogrel, should be avoided. Omeprazole, as omeprazole has got more drug interaction with antiplatelet, etc., and with ketoconazole, etc., should be kept in mind. So in conclusion, omeprazole should not be combined with clopidogrel. Proton pump inhibitor management should be done in GERD, acute peptic disorders, bleeding, stress ulcer, etc. It is indicated. Acid suppression may be inappropriate in outpatient and hospital inpatient because of many other factors. Always consider H2 receptor antagonist in a mild disease or a small dose of proton pump inhibitor. Do not start the very high dose of proton pump inhibitor in mild dyspepsia or early stage of dyspepsia and in case of a GERD. Always consider low dose and for short duration of proton pump inhibitor if the person has got cirrhosis of liver, because metabolism will be altered in presence of liver damage. Always remember, new studies of proton pump inhibitor are required. We have to look at the proton pump inhibitor in lot many ways. Suppress the acid, but not the heart and kidney. Because when you are suppressing the acid, always keep in mind that it can produce damage to the heart, kidney, as well as it can produce infections. There are a lot of complications like malabsorption of calcium, magnesium, and B12, etc. It can lead to a lot of those complications. So bone fractures. You should use safe and effective use of proton pump inhibitors should be identified. And you have to decide what you want to do. So I thank you all. I know your time is valuable. And I appreciate you for spending some of the time with me. So I end my lecture here. I hope this lecture will be helpful. And I wish from all of you, do not overuse or abuse proton pump inhibitor in any patient in which there is no indication for use of proton pump inhibitor.